The ancient Greeks wrote plays which featured music and songs, and Roman colonies included song and dance routines. The Middle Ages brought about church music and musical morality plays. However, opera was the direct precursor to musical theater, and the first opera that we ever see is Jacopo Peri's Daphne in the late 16th century. The first notable, fully staged English language musical work appeared in the late 1700s, which was The Beggar's Opera by John Gay. Throughout the next couple of centuries and earliest decades of the 20th century, musical entertainment changed. Through variety shows, vaudeville, and even burlesque, the classic American musical came to fruition. In fact, Jerome Kern and Oscar Hammerstein's Showboat was produced in 1927 and is often regarded as the first musical ever. Broadway became the epicenter for musical theater during this time in the earliest 20th century. In Manhattan's Midtown, surrounding Broadway Street, lives 41 theaters in New York's Theater District, or the Great White Way, which became its nickname thanks to the popularization of electronic signage outside the theaters. The golden age of musical theater's timeline is often debated, but most people consider the release of Rodgers and Hammerstein's Oklahoma in 1943 to mark the true beginning of the time period, and it lasted well into the late 1950s. Its namesake stems from the many musicals that debuted during this time. Over time, these shows and composers have become reserved as the best of Broadway. What about these shows was so great, though? Love, for one, is a huge theme during this time. Almost every show has the young ingenue and the big strong man who saves her, and something is always working against the happy couple. Stylistically, the tunes are consistently catchy. Between soaring and poetic love songs and upbeat dance numbers, these songs are recognizable for decades after their debuts. The formula for many successful Golden Age musicals reflected on the perceptions of the American dream at the time. It was a fantastic escape for the people of the time, and we continue to enjoy these pieces of theater magic today. The 1930s marked the Great Depression, but this terrible time did not stop Broadway. Playwrights and composers saw the need for lighthearted musical comedies. Cole Porter completed Anything Goes, which was produced in 1934. Power duo Richard Rodgers and Oscar Hammerstein collaborated on almost a dozen musicals into the 1950s, where the golden age of musical theater ended, and wrote The King and I, which was produced in 1951.
Thank you.
The 1960s would see a number of blockbusters like Fiddler on the Roof, Hello Dolly, Bunny Girl, and even some more risque shows like Cabaret. With the birth of newcomer Stephen Sondheim's career and dozens of record-setting shows, we also see the end of many Golden Age composers' careers, marked by the deaths of Cole Porter and Oscar Hammerstein, and the retirement of Irving Berlin. This was a decade of civil rights and sexual revolution, and thus entertainment begins to reflect these important social issues. The sounds of rock music are used in several Broadway musicals, beginning with Hair. Many composers spent this decade attempting to figure out what audiences were craving, and were gearing up for a big change in the decades to come. The 21st annual Tony Awards were broadcast on national television for the first time ever in the year 1967. Frank Lasser's How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying opened in 1961 and still held true to a lot of the same theatrical standards of the Golden Age. It was a fan favorite of audiences and won the Tony Award for Best Musical and the Pulitzer Prize for Drama that year. This show is the gold standard for what someone might think when they think musical theater. It's flashy and full of big dance numbers, dance breaks, and comedy. Didn't really push a ton of boundaries despite being chock full of satire, but it is a heck of a lot of fun. I actually got the great honor to perform in this show last spring, and unfortunately never got to perform it in front of an audience because of COVID, so I'm very happy to get to present it to someone now. At the end of the decade, Kander and Ebb's 1966 Cabaret was incredibly raunchy and very unusual for the time. It's almost quite the opposite of How to Succeed in Business. It challenged audiences and its musical predecessors. The juxtaposition of dialogue scenes with expository songs and separate cabaret numbers provided social commentary, and that was a novel concept that initially startled audiences, and they would often have audience members walk out in shock. Thank you. The 1970s brought a pivotal change to musical theater with the concept musical, in which shows were centered around an idea or concept instead of just being episodes with a cohesive narrative. Shows like Company, Jesus Christ Superstar, and A Chorus Line thrived among audiences. The most expensive tickets to hit Broadway yet hit $17.50 to see a weekend performance of Liza Minnelli in the act. A Chorus Line became one of the most popular musicals of the decade. It was profound and unlike anything ever produced up until this point. It is a true ensemble piece filled with comedy and heartbreak and mind-blowing dance numbers. It was filled with real-life stories from real auditions, and it painted the picture of relatable people and moments. It also won the Pulitzer Prize for Drama that year. In the moments after an unfortunate injury sends home one auditioning hopeful, one character poses the question, if today were the day you had to stop dancing, how would you feel? A lesser known show, which never even made it to Broadway, was Stephen Schwartz's The Baker's Wife. Schwartz had seen immense success with shows like Pippin and Godspell in the last couple of decades, yet this show struggled a lot. The production team and creators were not happy with the product and decided it was not practical to keep a production open, yet the production became a cult favorite with fans, particularly being drawn to the song Meadowlark, which ironically was the song that producer David Merrick was dissatisfied with in the first place. The Baker's Wife is a fanciful and touching love story that has been appreciated by community and regional productions across the country since its inception.
Forget what I did.
the 1980s saw the birth of the mega musical. The decade was filled with iconic, flashy, pop-influenced scores marked by Andrew Lloyd Webber, who produced no less than 4 shows in this decade alone, including Cats, Starlight Express, and The Phantom of the Opera. We begin to move away from the rock-inspired numbers of the last 2 decades and begin to embrace the pop sound of lush harmonies and power ballads. Stephen Sondheim is one of the most important figures in 20th century musical theater and has long been praised for having reinvented the American musical. His music and lyrics include unprecedented complexity and sophistication. He has won a myriad of awards for his compositions, including 8 Tony Awards, more than any other composer. Into the Woods is not only my favorite musical ever, but I also think it's one of the most notable examples of his work. It tells the story of various fairy tale characters and explores what happens with a lack of communication and goodness and the dangers of those things. Les Miserables is one of the most prominent examples of the mega musical from this decade. For every exciting and jaw-dropping ensemble number, there is a soul-crushing power ballad about death or despair to accompany it. Claude-Michel Schönberg does not hold back in this show's gorgeous orchestration, which paints a melodic counterpart to these tragic stories. Thank you.
it's these awards. Face the facts, find the boy, join the group, stop the giant, just get out of these awards. Was that him? Yes, it was. Was that me? No, it wasn't just a trick of the boards. Just a moment, one peculiar passing moment. Must it all be either less or more, either plain or grand? Is it always or is it never? And that's what woods are for those moments in the wood. Oh, if life were made of moments, even now and then a bad one. But if life were only moments, then you'd never know you had one. First a witch, then a boy, then a prince, then a moment. Wish only just for a moment, these are dangerous moods. Let the moment go, don't forget it for a moment though. Just remembering you've had it, and when you're back to war, makes the or mean more than it did before. Now I understand.
A new generation of composers are introduced in the 90s, like Jason Robert Brown and John Lacusa. Disney Theatrical Productions makes a splash on Broadway, and we see animated musical films on the stage for the first time, marked by Beauty and the Beast and The Lion King in this decade. The mega musical is losing a little bit of traction, and we're seeing musicals of varying styles succeed. While corporate musicals with glowing budgets are sweeping the Broadway stage, smaller scale shows like Falsetto Land and Little Shop of Horrors are finding critical and financial success off Broadway. Among the most notable 1990s musical theater composers was Jonathan Larson, who composed Rent in 1996. On the heels of the AIDS and HIV epidemic, Larson embarked on an adaptation of Puccini's La Bohème that also included aspects of his life intertwined into the story. The show was widely accepted by the theater community, who praised its representation of HIV-positive, ethnically diverse, and queer characters. The story is an incredibly important one, and during a time when fear was so high and spirits were low, Larson provides a beacon of hope and a message to instigate action. There's no day but today. The night before Rent's opening night off Broadway, Jonathan Larson tragically died of an aortic dissection and never saw it to the Broadway stage. He received 3 posthumous Tony Awards as well as a Pulitzer Prize for drama for this show. Jason Robert Brown opened his first produced show, Songs for a New World, in 1995, which is not a musical at all, but a song cycle. As an abstract musical piece, 4 actors, 2 men and 2 women, tell a series of stories through song, all connected by one theme, the moment of decision. In reference to the show, Brown has said, "It's about one moment. It's about hitting the wall and having to make a choice or take a stand or turn around and go back." Inspired by the likes of Stephen Sondheim, Brown has many trademarks in his composing style, which are often rhythmically dynamic and harmonically unconventional. Brown has 3 Tony Awards and is actively working on projects today.
Thank you.
In the new century, new material is actually lessening as producers find it more financially safe to produce revivals they already knew that people loved. Nostalgia plays a big role in media and performance into the 2010s because not only are we seeing old shows being revived, but a lot of the new shows that are being created are reminiscent of older American musicals or adaptations of other pieces of media. Shows like Legally Blonde, Thoroughly Modern Millie, and Shrek are all popping up in this decade and include those pop lush aspects of scores from the 80s, but all the comedy and fanfare of books from the Golden Age. 64 years after The Wizard of Oz was released, Stephen Schwartz composed the musical adaptation of Wicked, the story of Glinda the Good and Elphaba, the Wicked Witch of the West, and their unlikely but magical friendship. This very quickly became popular and set the precedent for pop musicals to come. Despite not winning the Tony for Best Book, Original Score, or Best Musical, Entertainment Weekly deemed it the best musical of the decade. The dichotomy of the two girls brings insight to this classic story never before seen.
Mr. Haggard, now that we're friends, I decided to make you my new project.
You really don't have to do that.
I know. That's what makes me so nice. Whenever I see someone less fortunate than I, and let's face it, who isn't less fortunate than I, my tender heart tends to start to bleed. And when someone needs a makeover, I simply have to take over. I know. Exactly. It's the toughest case I've yet to face. Don't worry, I'm determined to succeed. Follow my lead, and yes, indeed, you will be popular. You're gonna be popular. I'll teach you the proper poise when you talk to boys. Little ways to flirt in class. Oh, I'll show you what you.
Composers like Jason Robert Brown and even Andrew Lloyd Webber are still making a splash in this decade, but we also see the emergence of a ton of new people like duo Pasek and Paul, Anais Mitchell, Sarah Bareilles. There are also a ton of wins for women in this decade. In 2013, Cyndi Lauper is the first female composer to win the Tony for Best Score without a male collaborator for Kinky Boots. In 2015, Fun Home is the first musical with an all-female writing team to win for Best Original Score and Book. And in 2016, Waitress is the first musical ever to have an all-female creative team. We continue to see an emergence in revivals because they are a safer investment, but a lot of the original productions we're seeing are bold and new. In 2009, Lin-Manuel Miranda presented his concept for Hamilton, a rap bio musical about Alexander Hamilton and the founding fathers at the White House Poetry Jam. This marked the beginning of a decade of immense creativity and groundbreaking musical theater. In 2015, Hamilton opened to an incredibly receptive and excitable audience. It received a record-breaking 16 nominations at the Tonys that year, winning 11 of those. Casting non-white actors as the founding fathers and other historical figures, Miranda is quoted as describing the show to be about America then as told by America now. Tina Fey and her husband Jeff Richman bring back Fetch with a musical adaptation of Fey's 2004 film Mean Girls. The show thrived on Broadway but unfortunately closed earlier this year due to COVID. Feels bitterly apt that as the beginning of the new decade last year, we were hit by a worldwide pandemic that effectively stopped everything. On March 12th, 2020, the Broadway League called for a shutdown due to the coronavirus outbreak, which marked Broadway's first time going dark due to public health concerns. And the last shutdown had been almost two decades prior for only 2 days following the events of 9/11. Originally meant to last only 1 month until April 13th, 2020, the date has continually been set back and currently performances are expected to return May 30th. It is hard to say what the future of Broadway and musical theater will come to. If we take cues from the Golden Age, the Great Depression didn't slow down the turnout of musicals being produced at all. With the assistance of technology and Zoom, the ability to perform, even during the start time, has not slowed us down. While we can only hope that the existing shows on Broadway will indeed come back in May, many of the shows meant for the 2020 season have postponed their openings for late into the 2021 season or even 2022, including the Music Man revival and Flying Over Sunset. Despite the timeline uncertainty, I am confident in the return of Broadway and can't wait to enjoy live theater again.
You were mine. I thought you were mine.
10 in love again. This Peace Corps guy. I waited hours inside his tent with flowers, which made him laugh, which made me cry. By 13, I